That was very nice. Okay, so there's two ropes here. So there's the rope that runs over the pulley. All right, let's call that tension number one. And then there's the rope connecting the two boxes. Let's call that tension number two. All right, so here there are actually, there's a bunch of different systems we can look at, right? Because there are three masses, right? So our system can be any combination of those three masses. All right, what I usually find is that it is most beneficial to look at the system as a whole. All right, so if we do that, usually what I do is, when you've got a pulley problem like this, I always just draw the system as, I think what we called it last year was an amorphous blob, right? So the idea is you've got this thing that's kind of running over your pulley, right? Okay, and that thing can either go this way or it can go that way, right? Okay, so why do I comment on that? Well, if we look, let's think about what external forces act on my system, okay? So external forces would be any force that is not from one of the three blocks or the rope. Follow? So this amorphous blob represents the three masses and the rope. Follow?
Yep.
All right, so what forces are there? Well, there's gravity on the block with a mass of m. So that's going to be m times g, right?
Yep.
Okay, on this other side, we've got the force of gravity on the 2m and the force of gravity on the 4m, right?
Yep.
Everybody good with that? So those are separate external forces. So one of them is going to give me a force of gravity of 2m times g, and the other one is going to give me a force of gravity of 4m times g, right? Follow? All right, now let's talk about signs. Those all point down, so they're all negative, right?
No.
Okay, because within the context of this problem, those forces are not working together. They're working against each other, right? Okay? So what we need to do is we need to pick a sign convention. All right? And how you do this is somewhat arbitrary, but the idea is our little amorphous blob is either going to go this way or that way. And we need to pick one of those two directions to be positive.
Let's do
to
the right is positive.
So, yeah, I think to the right being positive makes more sense because in this one, obviously, that side is going to win. Follow? So let's make this positive and this negative. So let me pause there for a minute. Are there any questions on what I've done? Everybody cool with the weird amorphous blobness there that I got going on? Everybody cool? Hernandez? People? He probably didn't use that term. Are we everybody following what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Good? Okay, cool. All right. So now what I can do is I can find the net force on my blob, right? So that's going to be, well, let's see, negative mg plus 2mg plus 4mg is what, 5mg? Good? Any problems there? All right, and so now what I can do is I can find the acceleration of my blob. Well, that's equal to the net force of the blob divided by the mass of the blob. So net force we just decided was 5mg. The mass of the blob is 7, right? 1 plus 2 plus 4. Oops, sorry, it's supposed to be a capital M for whatever reason. And we're happy because the M's cancel, and so you get 5/7 G as an acceleration. Cool? So obviously you could come up with a numeric value for that if you want, right? Because you use 9.8 instead of G. Cool?
Yeah.
All right, so from here, it just becomes making a free body diagram for each of the individual objects. Okay? So, let's do this. So we had three blocks. One of them had a mass of m, one of them had a mass of 2m, and one of them had a mass of 4m. All right? Now, here's the deal with your sign conventions. Now we're dealing with specific objects, and each of those specific objects is going to either accelerate up or down, right? So at this point, my recommendation would be to, now that we're looking at a very simple system of one object, use the sign conventions you usually use. Do you know what I mean? Like, up is positive, down is negative. All right? So all of these blocks have an acceleration of 5/7 g, right? But let's talk about the direction in which they are accelerating. Going back to the original drawing shows us what direction is the block of mass m going to accelerate? Up. And the other two are going to accelerate down, right? So in my calculations here, I want to make these two negative, right? Follow? Any problems? All right. And so then the idea is each of these forces, I'm sorry, each of these blocks have two forces on them. Oh, actually, one of them has three forces. So here we go. So this guy has a force of gravity, which is mg, and a tension force, right? Yep. And we know our acceleration, right? Cam?
But why did we make the two of the four negative?
Because they're going to accelerate down in our original drawing,
okay.
Whereas this one's going to accelerate up in our original drawing.
So should mg be negative in this case?
Thank you. Cam, are you good?
Yeah.
Everybody good? Yeah. So the one thing that's a little bit confusing about this section is your sign conventions change a little bit, right? When you look at the amorphous blob, you have one sign convention. And then when you look at the individual objects, then you've got your usual sign convention. Make sense? Okay. So, let's figure out, was this force of tension 1 pulling on this guy? Is that right?
Yes.
From the original drawing?
Yes.
Okay. So, for this thing, let's do net force equals net force. So, let's see, our mass is m. Our acceleration is 5/7 g. That's got to equal our net force, which is negative mg plus force of tension. So I'm going to add mg to both sides. So I've got 1 and 5/7 mg, right? So force of tension is 1 and 5/7 times mg, or if you prefer, 12/7 mg. Did I do that too quickly? Just a little bit of fraction math? I say just. Like, we good? Hang on, just calculus. Oh, speaking of calculus, number 4 on the 5-3 assignment uses some calculus. Do the best you can with it. Pull over. Okay, thank you. Thank you for pointing that out. Did you get it right? Okay. All right. Everybody good with? Oh, sorry. This was all force of tension 1, wasn't it? Tension 1. Tension 1. Shh. Are we good?
Yeah.
Okay. Doing the other two blocks is basically the same. I'll do the 2M block now. So for the 2M block, this one's actually the hardest of the three because there are actually three forces on it, right? There's gravity, which is negative 2mg. There's the downward force from tension 2 and the upward force from tension 1. Follow? Everybody good?
Yep.
But we know tension 1. We just found it, right? It's 1 and 5/7 mg, right? Okay. And we know our acceleration is negative 5/7 mg. So I think we can just do, once again, net force equals net force. So ma. So I got 2m times our acceleration, which is negative 5/7 g, equals 1 and 5/7. Why am I using mixed numbers, you guys?
I don't know.
This was dumb. A bad decision. Minus 2 mg plus the force of tension 2. Cool?
Yep.
All right. And then you can solve for it and the force of tension 2 ends up being 1 and 1/7 mg. All right, and then you can repeat that process for the last book. Make sense, you guys?
Yes.
So really, the only weird part of this is dealing with the amorphous blob part. After you've done that, then everything else is basically the same as what we've been doing. Cool?
Yep.
Questions? Does that help? Everybody good?
Yep.
All right, so let's do the next example. This is another one with no numbers. It says the system here is in equilibrium. Find the tension in each rope in terms of M1 and G. So there's only two ropes here. All right? There's this rope, which I just drew in red, and there's this rope, which I drew in green. Cool? Oh, yeah, I guess, and then the one connecting the pulley to the ceiling. Sure. No.
Maybe does it mean the ropes of the pulleys?
Sure.
No, I meant it asked for two, and I was wondering.
I gotcha. All right, so let me turn off dual page, off. Let's embiggen this as scotch. Okay, so we're trying to find the tension in each of the ropes. So the red tension ought to be easy to find, yes?
Yes.
What's it got to be? M1G, right? So let's call the red one T1, and we'll call the green one T2. So look, here's M1. Force of gravity on it is negative M1G. It's in equilibrium, which means my net force is zero. So the force of tension 1 has got to be positive M1G, right? Follow?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Sarah?
Could you say that again?
Yep. Which part? The whole thing?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. So, I totally lost my train of thought. All right. So are you the red rope coils on there, the tension through that whole thing is equal, right? So if we just focus on this mass, there are only two forces on it. Gravity, which is negative M1 times G, and then the tension force, right? But it's in equilibrium. So everybody, what does equilibrium mean?
It
means our net force is zero, right? And eventually it'll also mean net torque is zero, but we're not there yet. Okay? So that tension has got to be big enough to make our net force zero, so it's M1G. Good? Everybody good?
Yeah.
All right, now. So let's look at this other pulley. So the other pulley has this. It's got tension 2 pulling it down, right? And then what's pulling it up? Sorry, force of tension 2. What's pulling it up, you guys? The rope on both sides. Force of tension 1 on one side, force of tension 1 on the other side. Right?
So those are both the same.
So those are both the same because the tension throughout your rope is uniform. Okay?
Oh, wait. Does that mean that one half of force of tension 1 is also equal to M2G?
Yes. I think you skipped a step, but yes. All right. So are we good with this? Yes, Patrick?
Why is it like that?
It's this. Look, if I hold the B like this, then I'm supporting the B with one force, right? Whereas if I do this, now I'm supporting him with two forces. So now the tension on each side is half as big as if I do this. Sorry? Shh. You guys, what?
Well, I don't really get how you know that each one is force of T1. Right?
Because one of the things that we learned is that the tension along the rope, as long as there's no acceleration along the rope, which that'll, once we start worrying about the mass of our pulleys, this will change. But for now, the tension along our rope is uniform, And so the tension on both sides is the same thing. Okay? I will, either tomorrow or whatever the day after tomorrow is, I'll have a, it's called a block and tackle, and it'll hopefully help you see what's going on there. Okay? And I meant to get it set up today, but I forgot to bring my ladder in from home. Yeah?
So why are we looking at the pulley and not the, like, the mass tube for the block?
No reason. We could have. We could have. So let's do this. All right, so we've already decided that FT1 is M1G, right? Cool. All right, so Daniel's asking about M2. So force of tension 2 has got to be equal to M2G. So absolutely, I was going to get there. I just hadn't gotten there yet.
Oh, okay, sorry.
No, you're okay. All right, so I think we know everything we need to know now, right? Because this is going to tell us that... I wish there was a quicker way to turn on dual page. Ah. All right, so now here's what we know. We know that 2 times the force of tension 1 has got to cancel the force of tension 2, right? Does that make sense? So, now we can just do some substitution, right? So 2 times, well, the force of tension 1 is M1G, and the force of tension 2 is M2G. Cool, and so the G's cancel out, and you find out that M2 is twice M1, which is what Patrick said, or Peter said, sorry, 5 minutes ago. Yeah, Sarah.
Sorry, how do you know that M1 is in equilibrium?
The problem tells you that the whole system is in equilibrium. That's okay. Do you see that?
Yeah.
All right, does this make some sense, you guys?
Yeah.
So the big thing I want you guys to understand, and I'm sorry I don't have a demo set up for it, I know I need to get that set up, I need to be better about that, is exactly what Patrick was asking about, which is make sure you understand that the tension along a rope is the same at every point on the rope. Okay?